towards the little card, he says, Dave, over at Heroic Replicas. Might do a close up of that card. He makes these Mastersword replicas. And he wanted to do a collaboration. And I said, sounds good to me. And so he sent over these aluminum cast parts. Hang on, closer. For the Mastersword from Zelda. Oh, the popular game. And so that's what we're going to be doing. He made these. We're going to be cleaning them up, modifying them a little bit. And then I'm going to be making the blade and all that stuff. And hopefully something that looks like the Master Sword emerges out the other side. Oh man. So it looks like this plate was sheared, which is odd to me. Oh. The Hardox, normally they can't shear it. They plasma cut it because it damages their shears. But I like that they sheared this stuff. It means they didn't damage the temper on it. However, the shearing did leave it bent for some reason. I don't know. It's like when you cut something with a tin snips or whatever. It's such an incredible amount of force. It must have made a hideous noise as it cut. Dicking around with it to try and straighten it out a little bit. More.
And as you can see, there's now no gap underneath the level.
My house suddenly filled up with people, but that's the template cut out. So on the original template, it stops here at this point. I want to extend it back a little bit and have less threaded bits on the back. And then, you know, who knows, I might even cut it back to weld a threaded piece back on. But for the moment, so in the world of things that should not be attempted, this is an old kettle from my house, electric kettle that broke after years of service, but the element in it was still good. Now the little square I cut out to weld onto the end of the plate was obviously didn't spend overnight in the vinegar, and because it's snowing outside, I'm not sure if it did spend the overnight in the vinegar, would it work? And because it's such a small square, I've thrown it in this kettle with some vinegar. This is full of boiling vinegar now. Well, it's not boiling yet, it's getting hot. I've noticed in the past that the vinegar works faster if it's hotter, so I'm going to try and boil the scale off. Lo and behold, it's not as dangerous as I thought it was. I heard a click and the vinegar had boiled. I thought I had bypassed all of the stuff about turning off when it had reached boiling. Now, can I get this guy out? Boiling vinegar fumes. Yo! Hot, 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 hot! So the width of the plate is 102 millimeters. I checked it here and here and it's the same. This was like 101.7. Grabbed the little nib of this thing, it said it was 0.7. So reduce the midpoint by 0.35. I'm going to mark it from both sides. I want to use the sides of this plate to draw the lines. So it's very important to me that they're parallel. I measured them to the best of my ability. Even though, bizarrely, one side is guillotine cut and the other side is plasma cut. I think it was either fresh sheet that had been guillotine cut and then they plasma cut out the section I ordered, or vice versa. But either way, both sides measure relatively parallel. See, I'm drawing the second line here, just for the sake of completeness, but you can see that it's not creating a larger black line. And then for this last part, can you see that? Very last part, and you can just continue the line this way. And boom. We have a straight line, and I'm gonna try and mark everything, or most of the big straights, by using the ruler square along the edge rather than tracing the pattern. So what I'm doing here now is I'm kind of marking the points in between the straight lines, and then I'll come back to them when I've got the distances marked out, or worked out the distances I have to mark. I've sometimes forgotten on the, when you draw a line with the grain, if you've sanded it, you really notice the Sharpie go into the grain. I could do this with a scribe too if I had one. Does this guy have a little scribe? Of course, the scribe is gone. The epoxied and mill scale surface actually takes a better line. Kind of sacrilegious to be taking measurements off the paper template when I have a file on my computer. You know, whatever. 65. I think this one was 3 1/4. 82.15. What's that if we switch it to... Yeah, 3 1/4. The noise you're going to hear in the background in this clip is Eben filing something, so if it grates on you, I apologize. So we go. First sanity check is 3.25. It is. Second sanity check. Does it actually match the template? It does, and so forth and so on. I want to do all the straight lines on it this way, by measurement, just to doubly make sure that we got the right thing going on. So it's a good thing I went back into the house to get measurements, because it turns out that the edge of the blade is not a straight line like I thought it was, but it's actually a very slight taper. Now, hang on, how do I get the piece of information that I actually want? I need a real paintbrush, but this won't work. I don't actually know will this work. Did that yield the piece of information? The piece of information I have is that it's touching here. Having nothing better to go with, I'll go with that. It took a lot of finagling. This plate bit here, just where it slopes down into the throat, is very different to the template now, I think. But, boop, fits on. With not too much movement. In fact, there's way more movement back here at the tail than there is up here at the throat. And I plan on doing something here. So hopefully that'll lock it into position properly. Well, that's me tired. I'll cut out the rest of this tomorrow. I found this hairy disc in the pile. Now, you should probably throw out hairy discs, but if I endanger life and limb, I can save $2. The SD card ran out of space, so it didn't see this thing getting cut out. Oh, come on. Hang on, can I get this guy out without... There we go. But that's the blade freed from the plate. Thing disc didn't explode. So now there's just minor adjustments to do. Should have gotten an actual measurement from the template. Taking caliper readings off a printout is kind of nonsense. Yeah, it's a little bit less than a half inch. What I'd like to see after I finish sharpening a side, an edge, is when you flip it over, is there any color distortion on its partner? And yeah, I can't see anything. You see the, I don't know, can the camera see the very, very tip? Can I do a manual focus and get that? The very, very tip got a little bit blue here, but that's all I got for heat distortion on the other side, so I think that was pretty good. So if you're a knife maker type guy, this is probably an okay bevel. But to me, it's ridiculously shallow. It's ridiculously shallow considering the tools I'm using. If I thought about this beforehand and I was making this from scratch, I would probably have made the sword from half inch thick stock that I could get this these lines very well defined. As it is now, it's, you know, slightly thinner than what I would normally use on the smallest of swords I make. I think I'll cut one out first and then compare them.
These things I'm actually very proud of, in terms of, I thought they were going to be a pain in the butt to make, but that wasn't too bad at all. So I'm not exactly sure. I might clamp it carefully, take this off, and then weld underneath. It'll be tricky, but that's the idea, is they sit there and there.
It really doesn't want to focus this close, but you can kind of see a mold line right there, and it goes all the way around the whole thing, and that has got to go.
That was relatively painless compared to what I thought it might turn into. Aluminum, I guess, is one of the ones that drills nice. Maybe it's brass. I have a memory of one of the softer metals being a nightmare to drill. Like, it just engaging in all sorts of bad behaviors when you attempt to drill it. Come on, come on. Got stuck on drill swath from drilling the hole on the inside. I resharpened the tip of this drill bit, but I still think it's not going to get through the hardox. But let's see. Okay, that left enough of a mark that I can work on it without damaging the guard. But yeah, it was starting to struggle, even though it got through more than I thought it was going to get through. Oh, it's starting to come out though. Finally! Holy moly! Will this guy go all the way through? No, is that because of this? Okay, it won't go through this, that's fine. Why won't it go through this? Will this goddamn thing go through? Still no. Is the hardox just beating up the drill bits? Is that what's happening? You're stuck now. That's all it took. Holy crap. There we go. I feel like that was much harder than it should have been.
So now we gotta get a couple of these little diamonds out of this big lump.
Hmm.
It happened that this nut with a exacto on top was the height I needed for drawing these lines. But it's always tricky, you know? Like when you're trying to draw weird lines like this, how do you go about it? And you usually just have to improvise. There's no good correct answer. I made this block just by squishing it in the vise. This is a very awkward thing to drill. Luckily, there's this groove here. Beep, beep. And this thing up here, so the thing is kind of locked in place. But I'm still paranoid about this guy winding up in the right place. Is that anything like lined up? Maybe. Yow! Yow!
Yow!
I guess it is. Whew! So I took it as far as I could with that little wood block. And here's hoping I can get the rest of it, that it got deep enough that I can try this and then burst out the other side without it going too funny. It has to burst out of a weird surface on the other side. I just want to get one final shot of this before I start drilling through the rest of this guy, because once I burst out the other side here and do the same on this other one, they're going to look real ugly until I get that pin through and weld on the top and shape it. So just while these things are relatively nice looking, just get a couple more shots of them. These were a real nice piece of shaping with the angle grinder, and they're about to be wrecked. It's called an airplane bit. Now, I don't know, it complained a bit going through, so let's see what we got. Ugh. So that's the idea, and then I'll weld on top of that to lock the pin in place and smooth everything back to being the way it was. But it, oh man, does it look ugly. Okay, this is hard to film, but with this guy on this side and this guy on this side, can this guy get all the way through? Okay, it can. Woo! So that's concern one. I'm going to test it on the blade to see, is it any different on the blade? But I have to nip these guys. Oh wait, that's the focal point. These guys come in a little bit too far, so I have to nip the tops, bottoms of these guys down a little bit, so the blade can slide in there as well. Actually, it'll be more visually thing if I go from underneath. Okay, so the pin can go through. Whew! And I'm gonna tighten the fit by, where's my other little guys gone? Tighten the fit by welding these guys on in very specific places. If I could clamp these guys across here, that would be perfect. But I need to do that in a way that doesn't mar them. Now, what would happen if I do this? Nothing. Good. What happens if I do this? Nothing so far. Good. Now to get a little bit of weld in there. Why is it so dark? There's something weird happening with the shutter speed. It acted odd when I was welding these guys. Okay, that's upsetting. So, even though the display was saying that it was on auto, like all the exposures and the everything, it wasn't. Can I switch focus version mid-clip? I can, and it's working. So, I don't know what the hell had just happened to the camera. I'm always slightly worried that bizarre arc effects from the welder will cause the camera's electronics to malfunction. I'm not even sure was that the case, but it certainly looked like that was the case. So who knows? Anyway, that's the things welded. Now, because of my dumb plan to get this anodized instead of painting it, this little patch here is made up of lab metal and must have been a hole or something. So, and that would work fine for painting it, but I need to get rid of it for my anodizing plan. Material has quite a lot of porosity in it, but I think that's all of the lab metal gone, so I could add thinner aluminum in. It will not anodize the exact same color, but I think I've seen from the sample piece I sent off, I think it should be acceptable. Oh man, it's ugly as sin. I've actually not welded a lot of aluminum, like ever. Focus. But it behaved okay. I was worried the porosity would make it a mess. But the aluminum was weird. It like, I had the thing set to 200, which if this was steel, would have been plenty of amps. But holy crap, it was like melting. It felt like I was using a little blowgun to melt toffee or something. Like it was coming off the stick in big blobs and stuff. Just a very different behavior from the steel. Not steel, aluminum. I just want to mention that for grinding this off, I don't even know how safe it is, but I'm using a sandpaper disc. I've heard horror stories if you use a regular grinding disc. See the way even the sandpaper that the aluminum has all bound up to the disc? If you do it with a grinding disc, if the aluminum gets too hot, it can expand in the cracks of the grinding disc and cause it to explode. So, no grinding discs on aluminum. I've gotten used to saying aluminum over here because the Americans think it's endlessly funny when you say aluminium. They ask you to say it again and again. So now we're going to attempt to etch, electro-etch the Triforce symbol onto the blade. I got my buddy who works at the high school to cut it out with the vinyl cutter. And so this guy is just for positioning. I'm just acetoning the surface because anything you can do at all to make sure that the vinyl actually adheres to the surface increases your chances of getting a good etch. And this is just to give a target, he said, hopefully. Holy crap. This kind of thing, very thin lines, is actually one of the most successful things you can try to etch. I found when etching big, wide, flat areas are very prone to failure. Much higher success rate with skinny things.
This looks to me to be a similar surface area to the markings on the demon-killing knife I did a billion years ago. So I'm going to check how long I left that in the soup for. And that'll give me an indication of how long to leave this in the soup for.
So I think I forgot to record it, so I just put a piece of clear tape on the design. I made it a little bit less sticky by doing this a couple of times. And now the stressful part is there's a square cut around the design. And can I liberate? Oh, here we go. Oh, perfect, perfect, perfect. I need to move the camera though. So the piece of tape on top keeps it all relative to each other, but I might move the camera over to where it needs to be so that you can see me applying it, which is a little bit more stressful. No, the light's wrong. God damn it. Maybe I'll bring this really close to the surface. Oh boy. Okay. The stickier you make it, the better it holds the design into position. The less sticky you make it, the easier this part is. Holy moly. So here we have the thing bubbling away. Piece of wire. Black is negative. The red's connected to the blade. It's 1 amp, 5 volts at the moment. And it's set to 1 amp maximum. So there, that's delivering the 5 volts. And I'm going to leave it in for 15 minutes and see what happens, because that would, like, this is even skinnier, I think, and even less amount of material to remove than was on the demon killing knife. They're very skinny lines. I don't have a universe B, but I wish I could see what would have happened if I left them in for half an hour. I'll have a look at the 15 minute mark and see, can I tell. So I'm having trouble focusing on the stuff underneath the water. But you can see the rust forming on the bottom as the salt etches away. I'm going to take this off and put my finger in here. No, it's not hot. I do not want it to get hot, because if it gets hot, the vinyl fails, the walls start to melt, it's a mess. Oh, so I'm just going to babysit it. Those bubbles are chlorine entering my bloodstream, making my thinking and speech patterns a little bit messier than they are normally. So this is kind of bizarre. See the yellow here? Normally the whole soup turns black, but with this soup it only turned black directly above the area it was etching. You can see here, this is yellow and this is yellow. I can brush it here. What I'm trying to detect is, okay, it looks like it got a clean etch. I'm trying to look into the bottom of what it burned, and it definitely looked like it's, ooh, the pattern's lifting. Okay, it's time to call it a day. The pattern's lifting, which is bizarre because it's still cold. So, I don't know. Oh, I hope I didn't wreck it. I guess we'll find out. Okay, I think it might be okay. Wow, even 15 minutes, I think, was a little bit too long. I'll leave in the other side for less time. But two things I want to do. I want to put coal blue into the cymbal to make it pop a bit more. And I want to brass these guys. So, because I'm worried about the heat, I have to sandbag both things when they're done. So I'm going to do the brass first. Now my problem doing this is always using too much heat, because I can't help myself. But you just kind of have to be patient. It's just a little bit of heat, and then you give it a brushy with the brush. Make sure it's an actual brass brush. God damn it. That burning on the surface. It looks like ebon when I gave him the job to clean it. He used quite a lot of acetone. Whew. Okay, that's one side of that done. Sand away all of this stuff. But yeah, so I tape it and then sand it all around the thing, obviously. And then that's way you can see the brass effect. I wonder. I think I liked it more when it was just silver. Yeah, the black, I don't know why. I thought the black would bring it out more. But the symbol, I think, is obvious enough without the black. I don't think it added a lot. Oh, there's still black there. The light in here is strange. Very harsh. So, people who have been following my YouTube will have noticed that this sword took a long time. And one of the reasons it took a long time is I didn't want to use paint on the guard parts because I don't like paint. It's just, I've never come across any version of it that's doesn't look like paint. You take your metal parts and you paint them and all of a sudden there's no difference between the metal parts and something made out of plastic or something. So, anyway. I got them anodized, and originally I was debating whether or not to make these guard parts purple or blue, but the anodizing place only had blue, so that's the color they are. Because they're cast, they came out kind of speckledy, but I still much prefer the look of this, and some of the welds, the textures and colors are slightly different around the welds, but yet again, I still am more comfortable with that than a painted finish. But anyway, this is done now, so the sword can finally move on to the next part. Originally, I was going to do the handle on the sword with two halves, because that's how the wooden pieces that were in the box with it were done. That anchored me to the idea of, oh, it's two halves of the thing that go around. But then I was thinking it would be actually much better if instead it was two discs, top and bottom, with a solid pipe in between. That one that flew off, I couldn't find it, so I actually cut a third one. Yo! It's hot. This disc of ice on top of the thing is thicker than I thought it was going to be. So in the back of the pommel, I luckily noticed that the hole was slightly off-centered, so we're going to make the hole in this guy slightly off-centered as well to try and match him up. And obviously it's a 3/8 threaded bar, so I might drill it bigger so then I can further like center this guy on the back of that pommel bit and then weld it on in the right location. And then the hope is when you tighten it down, it tightens down into this guy being actually centered. But it's a tricky, tricky thing to get perfectly right. I'm slightly worried about it. Now, is this thing... There we go. Ooh! Maybe not. But it'd be great if I could weld it on like that. With this head here. But I'm not sure how will that interact with the pipe bit. Ooh, maybe. But I also wanted to weld inside here. I'd have to leave space. Maybe I could weld it on like this and then shave that down or something. Okay. The inside of that pipe had rust on it, and although it's technically that, like, the... Oh my god, is this still too hot to touch? It's not like stuff rusts more. The only way it would rust more is if there was moisture trapped in there. But I'm always fascinated by this black surface that's on a vinegar boiled thing after it comes out. I wish there was a way to keep it on there. I've heard of people getting knives bit out of other stuff to turn black by boiling it in vinegar. Anyway, just clean out any loose rust from the inside. I made a big mess because I wasn't keeping an eye on it and it overflowed. It's over by the door. At least I had the good sense to do it by the door. Oh yeah, the inside of that looks clean now. Nice. I had a moment where I was like, oh, it won't work because there was paint on the outside of the pipe. And if they painted the inside of the pipe too, then the vinegar won't be able to boil it off. And then I was like, Mike, there's no... Why would they have painted the inside of a pipe? And I was like, oh yes, I am stupid. So I just acetoned all the marks off. But, so this is sit in that offset hole, and then it's tightened down. And then it was a real pain in the butt tightening it. And where's my vernier gone? By measuring off this edge, because like what else do I have to go off? You know, I drew two lines. One side, it was 7.36 or something like that for it to be the same distance either side. The other way it was 7. This is good to weld. I'm gonna weld this to this. And then this is tightened down a lot, but if it does come loose, I'll throw some thread lock in the hole and then tighten it down again. I forgot to look up whether how threadlock interacts with aluminum. Does it do anything odd to it? And if it does, if it turns out it does, I can use epoxy or something. Okay, I welded that, and nothing strange happened to the anodized surface. I really should have looked up how anodized responds to heat before embarking on this. But I guess I can go inside and look that up now for future reference.
Bird, bird, bird. Bird's the word. Bird, bird, bird. Where'd he go?
Time to drill some holes. You should not be in here. Those other guys will be back soon. I know. They'll be back soon. They'll be back soon. I know you're bored and it's cold outside.
You could stay in the house, you know? The floor here is covered in stuff that'll hurt your paws. Come on, we gotta go.
I can't remember why I have this, but this is a square needle file welded to the end of a piece of rebar. It's getting stuck, that means it might be nearly through. Having the holes drilled through is kind of good, because I can just keep going till they're gone, all the remains of the marks of them. Look, it goes on. Woohoo! First try. And that's because it's slightly baggy, but because I'll be welding it on here, it doesn't matter. So that's the idea. If I pull this back, you can see. These guys up here. The guard gets sandwiched between those two. This guy gets welded on the back before the handle piece gets slid up. And there's a pin through here. So if that's not good enough for holding the guard on, that's all I'm going to do. So hopefully it's good enough. There's two little marks on the back. I'm thinking I might weld one of them fully, like weld on top, clean it up, and then put them together and clamp it. But the only reason not to do that is if cleaning one up off the thing turns out to be drastically easier than cleaning it up when on the thing, the two sides might wind up look different. But that's kind of like betting on failure, so I'm going to assume that cleaning it up while on here is easy enough, and do one before clamping this guy together. Okay, so that's on there like that, but I'm thinking I might actually weld this part on first. Oh, pull back. This part on, because this guy has a little bit of a wobble to it, and the tighter I can get that before doing this pin thing, I think it'll benefit from it. Once I do this weld, the anodized part is now permanently part of the blade, so I'm a little bit nervous about it, but let's see how it goes. That was more awkward than I would have liked. Now I gotta very carefully flip it upside down. Okay, whoops. Did it move? No, it still feels tight. I'm gonna have to reclamp it and stuff before I do this other weld. Now this guy is permanently... Oh, there's still a little bit of wobble, but no wobble up and down. Hopefully when I get this in, then that'll take care of that last little bit.
What the hell?
God damn it! Ah, turn the gas off! Now, will this guy come out? Because it was pretty tight in there. Okay. Woo! So that was a pain in the butt, but, and it's going to be even more of a pain in the butt to do one in place. But as you can see, it's totally possible. What made this one a pain in the butt is I had to re-weld a part of it because of the gas at the start. Basically, none of the files or anything can go very far this way. The lump will be here. So, we've been trying to see, can I do this one? Keeping the angles controlled. I should shave a little piece off the pin. The reason I was freaking out is because if I moved at all and got the arc across the blue, I have absolutely no way of fixing it. And so that's why I was freaking out a little bit about doing that. But I think I managed to get enough weld on here. Also, the brass. I'm surprised at how well the brass is surviving. Like, I would have thought that the whole thing got cooked. But I guess it didn't get hot enough for that. Or the brass is put on thick enough for... Nah, it's probably just that it didn't get hot enough. If it's like the other side, the entire thing gets debrassed in the process of cleaning it up. But this part down here would be incredibly hard to rebrass if it got too hot. I hate this! I hate this so much! Stupid not being ambidextrous. This side is much harder to do for whatever reason, even though it's still the way I was doing the other side. I'd have to use my left hand to do this, and it's just not up to it. I don't have the accuracy to do this with the left hand. I squish myself at a weird angle to get this doing it with my right hand over here. Whew. Okay, that worked. It wasn't a disaster. I didn't have a slip where I bumped off this piece of leather I put for protection, so that was good. Now just to clean it up with the sandpaper. Can I get the sandpaper in here without causing a disaster? Oh, this is probably totally blocking the camera now. Oh, and so forth and so on. Too hot to touch, really. But that's both sides of this thing brassed, which is another advantage of spending all the money on getting it anodized versus the just using paint. Is there's no way I would have been able to do that process if this was just paint. This is too hot to touch at the moment. But yeah, that's the thingies. What's this? Some liquid came out of it. Ah, weird. Is that WD-40? It might be WD-40 from when I oiled the blade. Because it doesn't look like the anodize itself. The anodize is ink. They put the lump of aluminum in an acid bath, which opens up the pores. And I think that they have to run a current through it as well. And then it's regular ink, but it goes deep into the surface layer, into all the pores. And then they do that before it has a chance to get an oxide layer on top. And then the oxide layer on top is what seals that ink back in. And like I said, if this had been paint, there's no way I could have rebrassed these with the torch just now. I mean, I guess there's special heat-resistant paint and stuff, but I don't know, is there any... like oxyacetylene torch resistant paint. Wouldn't it be funny? Spend all the money to get an acetone, take the oxide layer off the top, somehow with the torch. And now this doesn't take off that ugly whatever it is. What the hell is that? It's late now. I'm gonna go to bed. I think because the slot is just a little bit bigger than this thing, there's still just this little bit of movement in it that I don't like, so I'm gonna try doing a thing. Okay, it's working. Now, next step. Where's all them 632s at? It's going in awful easy. Easier than I'd like. Oh, it's reached the end of it. God damn it. Am I going to have to modify this to do the thing I want? Maybe it already did. Solid as a rock. There's not a budge on that now. And I'm going to do a similar thing on the other side. Did I film myself cutting this guy off? Can't remember. But I cut that guy off. And I'm filming it from this side so that if the arc does something funny, hopefully it goes funny in this direction, which doesn't matter as much. People sometimes ask me, how do I make mistakes with swords? Or, you know, if I was doing them again, would I do something different? And this for sure. If I was doing this again, I would have pre-drilled two things in here and screwed it in like this way. And not had to drill a crazy diagonal hole while this piece was on the sword. That's kind of nutty. So, this is a little bit longer than it needs to be. And I would have to cut it down to here to fit the pommel piece in. But I like having this tail here, because the tail allows me to position this thing perfectly centered here. That's what these guys are for, tightening in against the sides so I can get the pipe perfectly centered and then do some welds. Oh, but like I said, the tail is, it interferes with putting the pommel on. So I'm going to score it, put this on, and then hopefully I'll be able to break it off afterwards. Maybe. I said hopefully. Okay, so I actually put in two more bolts here and here, and that they helped me greatly lining everything up. So these two bolts are holding this so that it's the same little level of difference all around here. And I don't know, was I talking about this earlier? The pipe is slightly, just a little bit bigger than this little 1-inch nugget here, but that's fine because I actually... handles that kind of pinch in at the bow ends are actually grab onto the leather better, I find. So I can weld a couple of welds in here and then get that in position and then weld this at the back. I might need, because of the distance in here, I might need to do something drastic to get a weld in where I wanted to get in. That's this section in place. I'm going to re-tinker with this and then I'll probably check in when I figure out how it is I'm going to get the welds I need. So, I realized after much fluting around that I don't actually need this tab. What I really needed was a way to check center. So what I've done is I've drilled a bunch of holes on the sides and stuff where I can access the tang on the inside. And oh, that's all I really need, is the ability to access the tang. Ooh, I might need to take this head off to get this in here, though. Will I be able to do this? Or will this be one of those clips where I go, damn, Hardox is very strong again? I'm going to try and snap off this bit now. And I wish I had snapped it off before. See, the... without having a thing welded on, this would have been... in the fictitious world where this thing inside here is welded on, this would be easier to snap off, but we're not in that world. Oh, there it goes, there it goes. And now, a second one. Oh, I think it might go. Yes. Okay, cool. And now I can weld this guy in here. But first weld this guy inside here and check that it's in the center before I do that using these holes. But I just noticed the time on the wall and my wife is feeling poorly, so I am making dinner tonight, so I may not get back to this till tomorrow. It's times like this that I wish I had one of those press button on the back style TIG welders. For some reason, grown-up welders don't like them. But I weld in so many weird, awkward positions. Like, I hardly ever do full runs. Oh, being able to tack things at odd angles would actually be way more useful for me. So I use the thing. Everything is the correct distance. I can't find to see the screwdriver now, but just little tweaks of the screwdriver, the tightenings of these. So, to the best of my ability, this is in the correct place, so I can get a great big weld here and a great big weld here. That's that locked into position. Get some more weld around here. Stick the pommel on. Okay, so at this very late stage in making the sword, I encounter a problem. This was obviously two halves of a mold that got squished together, but most of the depictions of the Master Sword I've seen, they show the thing as being this-a-way. But the problem with this-a-way, where this line here lines up with the sword, is the back of this guy isn't a square. Or it's not symmetrical through every plane. Like, it would be actually, I would love to mount it this way, but that's not how I wasn't able to find any depiction. Like, was it a matter of opinion? All of them mount this way, so I think I'm just going to have to mount it this way and not think about it too hard. Come on. So this is actually only stuck on with drafting dots. So the other side of this piece of leather, I ordered this leather online. Do I have a sample of it here? I don't know how the color and the lights in here will pick it up, but it was completely the wrong color. And I tried darkening, just make it darker, and it was just darker. And then I dyed this piece and threw in some green. See, this other side of it's too green. And now it's too light, but the problem with lighter colors is keeping them clean. I think this one would darken down as it's actually used by people who have grubby hands to the right colors.
Hang on.
It looks completely wrong in here. Yeah, no, the light in here is different because it's artificial light now. But in natural light, these look way closer. I give up. I'm using this piece of leather. Yeah, I think I'm ready to start putting it on. But I'm slightly stressed out about how finicky this is going to be. Yet again, this is the leathercraft cement stuff. There's so little of it left. I might actually cut the top off this bottle. I'm gonna try to make a note to order some new stuff. It's very important that I line up the tip of this. The bottom. I should have gotten some toothpicks. Maybe I did get some toothpicks. Something to push this in with. How far up? Oh, it's not even that far. Okay, so gotta get the glue out again. I love the way this glue almost instantly joins.
here. Get the glue again. I didn't want to overdo it with the glue because I thought it would take some finagling, and I didn't want to be finagling with glue that was drying and stuff, but I think it's going to be fine. Oh, and I should have mentioned that I'm using the suede side. The suede side came out way closer to the correct color than the leather side, and I treated the suede side with waterproofing stuff. Toothpicks. Something to rub this in with. Squish it in. Oh! It's moving around. I'm gonna wait till that sticks on before I do the next part. So what I've done here, because I was nervous that it was going to look wonky, is I squeezed a piece of paper around the outside so I could get an outline of the stripes, and then reversed it, and then taped it, and then cut it out so that I could get a thing that looks like what the second overlapping string of stuff looks like. And so I don't get confused while I'm messing with wet glue while doing this. I'm just going to put a series of dots where string number one overlaps, I'm putting one, and where the strand two overlaps, I'm putting two dots. It's very simple. I'm just super paranoid about getting confused about what I'm doing while it's all wet. So this is what that thing looked like, the tracing of this other one. Whew! See, this is why I was afraid of getting confused, because it looks so weird. I wonder how they get some of these very fancy leather wrap type things on traditional sword handles. And the answer appears to be, after looking at a few of those videos, is they always put the sword handle is always like a separate screw off part, so they can do incredibly fancy things with the handle because it's not actually part of the sword. You know, like they screw it on and stuff, but it's not like a permanent part of the sword when they're doing this extremely fancy stuff. And poor old me, I mean, this is a sword where you could have made a screw off handle, but it's just not how I make them. I generally make them that the handle is like a welded on component that's like a permanent fixture. So that's why I wind up having to do this stuff with struggling with putting the leather on while it's on the blade, which is not ideal. But I prefer having that than I don't know, it's probably fine with the smaller ones, but for the giant ones especially, I would never want a screw-on handle. Oh, okay. I'm going in to eat my dinner. So as I was brassing this, something boiled out from underneath here. I'd sprayed the sword blade with WD-40 while I was waiting for the anodized parts to come back. And I acetoned it and wiped it down. And I thought I had gotten all the stuff off, but apparently not. Or, inside the piece itself, there was some other mystery chemical from the anodizing place itself, although that also seems unlikely. So I think it was just stray bits of WD-40 boiling out from underneath.
So that's the sword finished. If you've been following along on my YouTube, you know that I've been making other stuff related to the test video, so I guess we might as well get on with that. Thank you to Dave at Heroic Replicas for sending me the aluminum parts, without which it would have just been a total... I could have done it, but it would have been even more work, and I couldn't have got the lovely blue colour if it wasn't aluminum. Just to reiterate, this is a charity build, so this will be going up for auction. For details of the charity auction, check the video description. For Dave, check the video description. If you have a link outfit similar to my link outfit, and you need the final finishing piece... this will probably be the only time I'm making one because it was an unusual set of circumstances. So send me a message.